All right, guys, super excited to talk to today's guest because this is probably the first time I've ever interviewed somebody I grew up with. I got Mr. Reed Dickens here. He is currently the CEO of LA Golf, amongst other things. So, Reed, thanks for joining us, buddy.
Oh, this is so super fun. I'm glad to be here. Thanks for having me on.
So, before we get into all the big things that you've done, we're from, Podunk, Louisiana. I'm still in Podunk, Louisiana. You're not anymore, but tell us a little bit about what it was like growing up in the Dickens household and maybe how that starts to kind of shape your ambitions later on in life.
A lot of it's a great question. A lot of the time, things that I thought were burdensome or torture at the time. Obviously, most people, including yourself, you look back and realize how much value it had, I think. But when I look back at my dad was he was the guy who we would mow lawns all day, and we would come home and take a shower and be getting dressed to go to the movies with our friends or something, and he would come in and make us put our sweaty clothes back on and drive all the way back across the town just to mow one little strip that we missed. And he was big on not avoiding mediocrity if you're going to put your name on something. And I think, but we had a very structured, very, very religious, structured, strict environment. But part of that, we didn't have a television, we didn't have any money. We had a pretty, pretty rough economic, stretch of our life. My dad worked at a paper mill, and then when the paper mill shut down, we had a rough 10 years or so. And I think looking back, all those down hours, right, of nothing to do and nowhere to go, and we didn't have a car and whatever, and no entertainment, no TV, no Nintendo. I felt so deprived, and felt so sorry for myself, right? Which is most, I think, entitlement and self-pity are the two most dangerous emotions. But looking back, I spent thousands of hours reading trivia pursuit cards and memorizing things out of the dictionary and reading encyclopedias, right? And I kind of became addicted to processing, two things. I kind of became addicted to interesting data points, and I think I also became good at processing larger amounts of information and retaining, memory recall and retention. And I think as I look back over my last 25-year career in politics and entertainment and sports and corporate world, private equity, entrepreneur land, I think that's turned out to be really useful. And I think I still find myself having that addiction to like interesting data points and factoids. And I really think that's the thing that I'm so comfortable with silence. And one of the things I talk to my kids about and young entrepreneurs about all the time is that Warren Buffett, I think he was probably bastardized in a quote from, I think it was Sir Thomas Aquinas, said that all of man's mistakes come from not spending enough time in quiet. And I think most CEOs and businessmen pride themselves on being busy all the time and working all the time, that productivity is being busy. And I actually have always placed a high value on quiet, quiet time. When I ride in my Sprinter from Newport Beach to Beverly Hills and have an hour and a half on the 405 freeway, I don't bang through my call list, although my assistant and partners would probably love for me to. I stare out the window and think for an hour, right? I spend an hour every morning in my sauna, go to work out at 6 a.m. and I spend an hour in my sauna without my phone, just thinking, right? And I think my comfort level with silence and alone time and quiet came from that kind of overly that structured environment I grew up with, where a little bit of poverty and a little bit of lack of entertainment. And now I don't know if my kids have ever had a quiet moment,
Yeah, and it's crazy because, when we were growing up cross street from each other, even though we had television, we didn't have internet and cell phones and all the stuff that kids have now, but we had this huge yard, Mr. Gilchrist's house. Then I had a basketball goal. Man, that was like entertainment year round, football games, basketball, I mean, baseball,
Yeah, I don't know that I ever played organized baseball, but I was convinced at your house I was going to break the Guinness Book of World Record for free throws, And so you're right. We always put ourselves to work.
So tell us, I know you had an experience in high school, when you were, I don't know, 16, 17, something like that. You were ev evangel, right?
No, actually, if you're talking about the political, my first political exposure, I was still at St. Frederick's. I went to visit Air Force Academy.
Okay. So when you had something happen, you saw a helicopter land and that kind of changed it. Tell us about that.
I mean, I think it's one of the, if I'm going back, I think life is made up of moments. I think that was a moment that really changed the trajectory of my life. I saw Bill Clinton was speaking at the graduation, the helicopters, the Marine one, the white tops, they come in two batches of four and they play this shell game and they're all rotating and they don't want you to know which one he's on. And unfortunately, I found out all the reasons why later in life, but he landed and got off all these young people got off the helicopter with him, and they had two cell phones and he was yelling at them and whatever. And I just looked at my friend I was with and I said, I'm going to do that one day. And he said, do what? And I said, I'm going to work for a president. He said, how? I said, I have no idea. I really didn't even know what a Republican or Democrat was. I didn't know an embarrassing low knowledge, as Nate Bargatze talks about. I didn't know anything about politics. And the crazy part was that led to me really going on this like relentless pursuit of how to get to DC. And I, actually looked up my congressman's name in the blue pages of the phone book and called every day. And they finally called me back and said, you can come up for 10 days. And I didn't even know that wasn't a real internship. And I just wouldn't stop calling. They were probably going to turn me over to security or let me come up there. And so I met a lady who went on to work for Governor Bush in Texas. She wouldn't respond to my emails. I sent her hundreds and hundreds of emails and finally went over to Texas and kind of talked my way past the security guard and lived on a stranger's couch and volunteered and became an intern. But the crazy part was that kind of relentless kind of pursuit of that mission. I ended up landing on that same helicopter in the same parking lot at Air Force Academy with the next president, right? And so I just always use that as a visualization exercise for young guys and young entrepreneurs, that visual of, I remember landing on that same Marine One helicopter in that same parking lot 7 years later, maybe, with President Bush. And it was the journey from, there to there was not a straight line. And it was, I went to the grocery store and bought stationery with American flags on it and typed a letter and sent it to everybody I knew and said, hey, US, the Congress has chosen me to come to DC. And I wasn't even being dramatic. I actually thought it was a big deal. I didn't realize I was one of 100,000 interns that summer. And there's a lot of funny comical elements to the story, a lot of Forrest Gump components to the story. But at the end of the day, I do think there's a really powerful, powerful, element or kind of thread to that story, which is just having something, having a visual. And really ever since then, when I look back over the last 30 years, my entire life has been a series of 5-year visuals. I don't ever come up with long-term goals and long-term life goals. I have some general, directional things for my family or my life. But for the most part, I've kind of operated for 25 straight years with a 5-year visual, right? I have a 1-year goal that gets me further in that direction, but 5 years out, I think, having a 5-year plan is kind of bullshitty, right? I don't think you can really have a 5-year plan because so many things, in the middle of that 5 years, 9/11 can happen or COVID can happen or whatever. It's hard to have a 5-year plan, right? I try to have a 12-month plan, but I try to have a 5-year visual. And I think that all started when I was 16.
So what would you say, I talk to a lot of physicians and dentists all the time. And when we get out, we're 28, 30 years old. It takes us a long time to get through school. Yeah. And we meet most of the time, we'll just meet with the financial advisor or something. They'll go, okay, well, here's your 40-year plan. From 30 to 40, you're going to work one job and you're going to put money in a 401k. And then when you're 70, 65 or 70, you'll live happily ever after. And that's really the only goal a lot of these people put. So what would you say to somebody in a position where they may have gone to school a long time, physician, dentist, attorney, pharmacist, something like that. And they want to do more than just that path. But they don't know anything about goal setting or anything like that. And you mentioned visualization, manifestation. What are maybe some of the key things that you would recommend somebody in that position?
Well, so I think what you're addressing is something I talk about often when I speak at business schools or when I meet with entrepreneur groups or whatever. I spend a lot of time talking about being a generalist versus a specialist, right? And I think our parents and grandparents and great-grandparents, we got raised by multiple, a multi-generational kind of impact from the Great Depression, right? Where we really got brainwashed to specialize, right? And then I think for folks who are smart enough to, I wasn't smart enough to go to, you know, I wasn't well educated or smart enough to go to med school or dental school or whatever. I kind of was like, oh, I've got to get a job, right? But for people who specialize, which is usually the higher, you know, the better performing students, the higher IQ, cream of the crop end up going to law school, dental school, middle school, you end up, you know, waking up at a certain whatever age, 40, 45, and you're like, well, is this what I want to do till I'm 75, right? Or maybe there's not enough flexibility financially, or maybe it has a ceiling financially or whatever. And so I think when I'm talking to young people, I'm always like, hey, I would recommend being a generalist. And then when you really know who you are and what you want, you can always specialize. But I'm talking to someone, a group of people who've already specialized, right? I actually spoke to a large group of lawyers the other day, and we had the same conversation. I think I always recommend people read the 4-Hour Workweek, you know, Tim Ferriss's book, The 4-Hour Workweek. It's such a great kind of wake up call, right? To give yourself maximum flexibility and maximum optionality and create passive income at all costs, no matter what you have to do. And it kind of becomes self-aware of all the wasted people and motion and energy in your life, right? I think one thing that I really got, I read The 4-Hour Workweek probably 15 years ago. And the one thing that impacted me from that book is that the majority of the emails in your life don't matter. The majority of, you know, things you do every day don't matter. The majority of people you have coffee with and have lunch with don't matter, right? Like, and I know that's kind of the opposite of what I was, you know, I was raised to think that you should, you know, kind of be mingling and networking with every person possible. But the truth is, most of the energy we expend in a week are on things that aren't impactful to our lives, right? Now, I think doing a really careful, thoughtful audit of your life, of the amount of hours you have in your week and the hours you have in your day, and how many of those hours and how many of those tasks and how many of those energy calories that you're dispensing are going towards something that's actually going to move the needle. And a lot of people haven't even identified what their needle is, right? So I think it's a lot of quiet self-reflection. A lot of times people take off running, right? Because they hear a motivational podcast or speech, or they read a book and they say, I want to have passive income, or I want to have this much money in the bank by this age. And then they just take off running, and you say, hey, where are we going there? I don't know, but I'm trying to run faster, right? I think the first thing to do when you're evaluating how do I have the most optimal impact, right, with my life or my resources, how do I achieve whatever my version of success is, I think the mistake people make is they don't spend enough quiet time figuring out what the needle is, right? They don't figure out. I think one of the biggest blessings of my life was having a few mentors and a few friends, people that I knew early in my life, like late 20s, early 30s, who helped me redefine that, hey, that guy who has the private equity, he's a private equity partner. He's going to make $10 million this year. He sits on 13 boards. He travels 220 days a year. He misses every kid's football practice, every dance recital. He wears a suit 7 days a week. He travels nonstop, but he makes $10 million a year. Do you really want that $10 million a year? Or would you rather have an internet business that makes you $500,000 a year, but you have complete control of your time and where you are in your environment? And so I defined success at a very early age as, and it's a spectrum, right? It's not a destination, it's a spectrum. But I kind of defined success for myself as having as much control of my time and environment as possible. Environment defined by your physical location, the people you're around, the information you consume, just your ecosystem. And having control over that environment and my time as much as possible was my version of success. And every 5 years of my life and every 5 years of my career, I look back and go, well, I haven't made the money I thought I'd make, or I haven't done this, or I haven't done this, but I do have way more control of my time and energy and environment and who I deal with and who I have to deal with and who I answer to. I have way more control over that than I did 5 years ago. And that's kind of always been my directional vector and my kind of journey. And I define that at a young age. I meet a lot of people in their 40s and 50s who are still behaving as if having a certain amount of money in the bank is their defining vector. And by the way, there is a lot of freedoms and benefits that go along with putting a certain amount of money in the bank. So I'm not dismissing liquidity. I would love to have some. But I think being very clear, right, on what's important to you and factoring in quality of life and health and time with your kids and trying to figure out what that kind of Venn diagram looks like. I don't think people sit quietly for long enough. So that's what I mentioned when we were talking before this about the one thing, the book, The One Thing. One of the things I liked about it is that he said in there that sometimes your one thing is taking an entire year to figure out what your one thing is, right? And I think people skip that step, right?
Yeah. Yep. Gary Keller with Keller Williams.
Yep.
He wrote that book. Yeah. When I, and we'd mentioned this before, I'd interviewed, actually, I went to Grant Cardone's office and kind of laid out my plan for my real estate business and stuff. And he kind of looked at all my numbers. And, you know, at that time, and I'm still kind of not so much all over the place, but a little bit. And then he pointed to one number, one specific metric. And he said, Jeff, what would happen? You know, he's the 10X guy. What would you happen if you 10X this metric? And I was just like, poof. Never even, that just started opening up my mind. Like, he's like, you know what? That's what you should focus on. That right there, that metric. And you're right. And it's even worse now with all the, you know, we didn't have social media and cell phones and all that. Now people are so distracted. That's one of the reasons I like to go deer hunting.
Right.
There's no cell service. It's quiet. And I can just sit there and think for a couple hours. And you're right. People, we just don't do enough of that.
Yeah.
So I'm curious, you were in the White House with Bush around 9/11, maybe before, after. Do you have any, you know, cool stories, or you have anything that just kind of comes to mind, like that you really are, that you really remember, or very remarkable moments during that time?
Yeah, I mean, I was very, very fortunate to have some incredible moments. And, you know, I've talked about this on other podcasts because it's, I'm always careful to disclaim that I, you know, I was not a big shot. I was not important. You know, he jokingly called us youngsters level fives. I just happened to be, you know, had a front row seat for some of the most historic events in our country's history, right? And that front row seat, you know, taught me a lot of lessons observationally, but also my actual job. You know, even though I was a junior level, you know, guy, I got to be in the room a lot of times for cabinet meetings or CEO meetings, or when the president was arguing with his senior team. I mean, he was such a confident, President Bush had so much confidence, and he was so comfortable in his skin. He had a handful of people working for him that all thought they should be the president, right? And I learned a lot from that, right? Because when I'm right now working on a deal that could put me in a much larger platform, and I'm already considering putting three or four people around me who are probably more qualified to be the CEO than I am, right? And so I learned so much from watching him. And, you know, I actually kind of by fluke, while I was taking the 12-person White House press pool is what it's called, the little rotation of reporters that get to cover the meetings on that certain day. And the press pool that was in the, you know, the press, the reporters that were in the press pool on 9/11 obviously got a historic assignment, right? And I took a bunch of the reporters in the Oval Office for that evening when he gave the address to the nation. And, you know, I had to wait for the cable. And they had to like physically unhook the cable from the Rose Garden flower bed to pipe the TV. I mean, this is like something our kids won't even understand. There was no cloud back then. And I was waiting, standing in the Oval Office, waiting on the guy, a few of the mechanics out in the Rose Garden to break down their equipment. And it was just he and I. And it dawned on me that in the movies, the president always had this team of cabinet members with their ties loosened and a scotch and a cigar. And they're all, he's got the smartest people in the world huddled really closely, whispering. And I mean, at the time, they thought 9/11 was going to be the first of a five-wave attack. And there were tanks in the streets and the world was kind of melting down. And he's just by himself in the Oval Office, right? Every senior level person was home with their families. They were all escaped. And so I was this 25, 26-year-old kid in the Oval Office by myself with the president on the night of 9/11. I mean, there were just some moments like that that are almost surreal even now to look back on. And then the night he threw out the first pitch, I gave my first on the record briefing, and it wasn't a long briefing. I think my quote was one sentence, which was, it was right down the gut, but he threw out the famous speech at Yankee Stadium, and you know, all the reporters gathered around me. I was on the field behind home plate at Yankee Stadium that night. And, for probably the most iconic sports moment of all time. And the reporter, the female reporter from Bloomberg News yelled like, "Reed, what was it?" And I said, "It was right down the pipe." And I think that quote was on the front page of like 7,000 papers in 40 countries. And so, yeah, I'm making those numbers up. I have no idea how many papers there were, but it was a It was a really surreal experience for that to be my first kind of, you know, on the record White House spokesman gig, right? And so there were lots of moments, you know, traveled the world on Air Force One and played a lot of gin rummy up in the conference room with President Bush. And I got to golf with him and run with him. And, you know, I was at his ranch. Every time he went to his ranch, was out there chopping cedar with chainsaws. And so it was just, it was an incredible Forrest Gump type moment. And when I look back, you know, I get asked all the time, you know, what would I do differently or what do I regret? And I always say, I regret that I taught. Like when I look back, I'm just like, why was a 26-year-old in the Oval Office? Why was I ever talking? Like it was crazy to think that he would call my desk and ask me my opinion or call me in and start yelling at me or, you know, griping at me about something and asking me about a press conference or something. I mean, the fact that I was in a position at that age to get in trouble, right? To be getting scolded by the President of the United States in key moments and him asking me questions or want my opinion about something. Sometimes you're the only one near the president, right? All the senior staff level people are gone. And, you know, you have these moments where you're getting grilled by the President of the United States in a key moment and you're 26 and it almost lends itself to self-pity. Like you go lick your wounds and feel sorry for yourself and be like, well, like, it's not, it's your fault. You have a 25-year-old in the Oval Office, right? Like, and so I look back at those moments and I just think, man, I don't even like having young people in my office when I'm trying to do important stuff. I don't know, you know, I don't know how I ended up in that situation. So it was a surreal time. President Bush was a incredible mentor, incredible leader, and boss. And I honestly have been clean. Obviously I've been clean from politics for 20 years. And I think both parties are like 100 years outdated, but I do know that presidents, I don't know that we've had another president or that we will have another president that was as methodical in terms of decision-making process to only be thinking about what was in the 100-year interest of the country in spite of the consequences on him politically. If he wanted to have his favorabilities higher or his polls higher, he could have done a lot of things that he would have considered short-sighted decisions on behalf of our country. And so I really was... fortunate to get to be up close and personal with, you know, I get to, sometimes it felt like I was shadowing the CEO of the United States, you know, a $25 trillion economy and during two wars and all the stuff going on. And just to get to see what big picture strategic thinking at scale looks like and crisis management and decision-making and internal politics and, you know, conflict resolution and just all the things I got to. While most people that age are making copies or coffee for their boss, I was getting to have a front row seat to somebody having to run the country at a really messy time in history. So it was an incredible experience that I still to this day benefit from.
So you just mentioned a little bit crisis management. So you went from the White House to starting to become an entrepreneur business owner. And that was with crisis management. So tell us a little bit about that and then we'll move into your next company.
Yeah, so I would say I was born without what they call a skill. So I moved out to L.A. and I didn't know what I was going to do. And I was really kind of too young for the jobs my resume would qualify me for. I had a great resume, but I remember the lady who was one of the top management. She was one of the top senior staff executives at Disney for Bob Iger. And we had lunch with Bob Iger one day and I was interviewing for this big job and I was completely qualified in terms of the experience I just had and the resume I had. And she was like, I have to be candid with you. I just can't put all my 55-year-old VPs reporting to a 27-year-old EVP. She was like, I just can't, it'll just cause me too many problems. And at the time, it really discouraged me, but I realized that was the sliding doors fork in the road for me. Of what made me become an entrepreneur is that the jobs that I thought I was qualified for, they're like, you're not old enough for, which is a really interesting dynamic. And so I knew every reporter and news director and producer of every, you know, evening news and morning shows and newspapers. And so I kind of made up this kind of role for myself. It was kind of a fixer, right? Where I was negotiating scandal, you know, negotiating, trying to resolve. It was really a problem solving role, right? Where I was trying to solve scandals for A-list celebrities and a few governors and a few CEOs. And it turned into a really lucrative business. And I joke all the time when I speak at business schools that my entire life goal when I moved to LA was to make $1 million. And I ended up making $1 million in my first year and it cost me 1.6, right? So those were all There was no WeWork. There was no WeWork back then. I had 12 employees and furniture and a $30,000 a month office space. And there are lots of painful, valuable lessons. But yeah, so that I ended up doing that for a few years and selling the business to my a partner of mine who wanted to, he kind of wanted to stay in that world. And I had been around, I had been watching and being around all of President Bush's friends and donors. And I was really enamored with, I wanted to be a business person, right? And I didn't really even know what that meant. I didn't know what that looked like, but I wanted to be a business person. And at first I thought I wanted to be a CEO until I became a CEO. And I realized, no, I want to have some CEOs. So I had my, you know, my vision kind of evolved, but I really, that was a great, you know, I had a great networking skill because I had that person, you know, I had that drive and hunger and curiosity to network. But I think managing all those crises for people in so many different industries, sports, entertainment, Wall Street, healthcare, it really did build a great network. I ended up the first real business that I raised money from. I raised half to two thirds of the capital for my first deal from people I had managed a scandal for. Right. And so it was kind of interesting how that evolved.
And then tell us about going from there, and then you going into Marucci.
Yeah. So
I
had been working on this little a failed venture with the Jonas Brothers. They didn't fail. I just my project with them didn't work out. And so I had raised a bunch of money and then the economy crashed. So my little brother was the kind of, I don't know, personal chief of staff to the governor of Louisiana at the time. And my co-founder, who was an LSU legend, he went in to ask for some advice. He had a wood mill he had purchased from the Amish, bunch of Amish families that had all this maple wood that was 7% harder than the Louisville Sluggers. And he had a wood mill and they had this kind of bat shop. They were making bats for professional players, but it wasn't a scalable business. And they wanted to set up a commercial enterprise to really monetize what they were doing. And so they didn't really know how to raise money. They had been trying to and had all these players that were interested in investing, but they hadn't actually gotten any deals done. And so we started Marucci Sports. I remember buying the domain on GoDaddy for like $10, and just like I did LA Golf. And I basically said, I'll raise the capital and I'll build the brand, but I want to be the CEO. And Kurt said, you know, deal. And so Kurt ran the operation and the baseball side, and I ran the, you know, did the fundraising and built the brand from scratch. And I helped us, you know, I brought in some people to build the supply chain in China. And I went and flew to Pittsburgh and pitched them on why they should take our product, even though I didn't have a finished product in my hand yet. And so we kind of built that brand, that company from scratch. And it was a long, messy journey. I was the CEO the first few years. I was the executive chairman for, I don't know, four or five more years. And then we exited in 2020, and everybody made, you know, four or five times their money. And it was a good outcome for everybody. But it was a really, you know, for somebody who didn't go to business school, who didn't have a lot of sophisticated, I didn't have a lot of sophisticated knowledge about business, about capital structure, about, you know, business models. I just didn't know a lot. It was an incredible learning experience that led to a lot of painful lessons, but it was a good outcome for me personally, and it was a good outcome for our investors. And I guess that's really the key to any business you start from scratch, is it needs to be a good outcome for everyone.
So what inspired you to create LA Golf, and then how, maybe when you were creating it, how did your approach differ from what you did at Marucci?
Yeah, that's a great question. I joke all the time, and it's, you know, as the Russians say, there's a little humor in every joke, that I owe everything in my life to politics and baseball, and I never really liked politics or baseball. So I was in the desert with some friends and was playing on GoDaddy, which is how I guess all good entrepreneurial ventures start. And I was playing around looking for golf names because I had this one company I wanted to go to try to raise some money to buy. It was a simulator company. That deal ended up not going through. But what did happen was I ended up with the name LA Golf for about $10 on GoDaddy, right? And so I just had this epiphany. One of my investors actually helped me have the epiphany that I could just redeploy the same playbook in golf that I did in baseball, right? I bought some assets for what was a bankrupt shaft company. I bought The equipment and inventory. So I bought about $7 million of assets for $1 million. And I realized, wait a minute, this is the Marucci story. Marucci was the only American-made bats. And, you know, so Dustin Johnson and Bryson had both reached out to me, and we had started talking. And they were basically said, we want to invest in whatever you're doing. And so it, all of a sudden I realized the things I wanted to do differently. In Marucci, we had about 40 baseball players that were investors, and about four of them were helpful, and the other 36 were a pain in the ass. And in Marucci, I had two co-founders, and we all had equal voting rights, which was a disaster. And so there was a lot of structural governance things that I wanted to do differently. So LA Golf really is, it's the same playbook as I did in baseball, right? Which is, and the playbook is simple. Only put our name on things that the best players in the world would use. Make sure there's a material science or technology story to anything we put our name on. Make sure the branding is very provocative and playful, and make sure our gross margins are in the 60s, right? It was a very simple playbook, but it takes some discipline, because the hotter your brand gets, you get so many opportunities for acquisitions and products that aren't really worthy of your brand, right? And so it's really about prioritization. And so deploying the same playbook, except the difference is our golf is 20 times larger. Our gross margins are probably twice as good. I'm 14 years more experienced, and I have no co-founders in full control, right? So it's the same playbook, but it's kind of tweaking all the structural flaws that I had with the first company.
So tell us about, so for somebody that doesn't know what LA Golf is, or what you guys do, what, give us the quick version of that.
Yeah. So LA Golf, there's really not a comp for what we're trying to build or what we are building. Because in golf, the major equipment brands, the major equipment companies, there's a few things that are fundamentally flawed in golf. I've often said that golf has kind of normalized what I would consider consumer fraud, right? Which is, they sell you a $600 driver and it comes with a $4 flimsy shaft. They sell you a $500 putter and it comes with a $3 steel shaft. And they know that that product isn't optimized to what you need. And they make you, and so the analogy I use is, if you went and bought a Porsche, and it sounded funny, and you took it to your trusted mechanic, and they said, well, Jeff, I don't know what to tell you, but this has a Honda Civic engine. You need to pay another $200,000 for a Porsche engine. Then you'll have a complete Porsche. You would sue them, right? But golf has normalized that. You buy a driver, and then you have to go pay another $400 to have to optimize your distance and dispersion by buying the shaft you need. And so we started with the shaft, which, just like in wood, with wood bats in baseball, it's kind of a tool of the trade. And and then we started from there. Then we made the first ever carbon putter that has a sweet spot that's a lot larger and has a descending loft face, so the ball rolls immediately. And we spent about $1 million on a patent for a ball that's the only ball that I know of that's outperforming Titleist Pro V1. And so we're trying to attack about one category per year, and we're trying to make sure that whatever product we put out is best in class. And so we make all 14 shafts. We have four putters. We have a ball. And then we have some other big categories coming soon. We also have apparel and accessories and soft goods and bags and things like that. So I'm going a lot faster than we did in baseball. So we're in year four, I guess. And we're already, you know, we already have our products distributed in probably in 15 countries and a couple thousand locations. And hopefully we'll be in some other major categories in the next year or two.
Awesome. Well, as probably everybody listening to this can tell, you're a very successful entrepreneur. So I've got kids, you've got kids, you've got four kids. We talked about that before. How do you balance between the demands of your professional life and then the demands at home? Because that's one of the things that I'm always trying to figure out too.
You know, it's hard. I mean, I wish if you, I was hoping you'd have the answer. I just said to my, the last thing I said to my wife walking out of the house this morning was, I didn't get to spend the time this weekend with the kids I wanted, but our spread is big, right? Teenagers, little ones, whoever. And I said, I didn't get to spend the time I wanted to, that I planned to this weekend. Everybody was all over the place. And I said, the last thing I said before I walked out the door was, I said, I've got a crazy week, but I'm back in town Thursday. Let's instill some boundaries and make sure there's some forced family time, right? You know, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. Let's make sure you and I go to dinner. Like, we all, like, let's not talk about going to dinner. Like, pick a night and let's make sure we go to dinner. And so I think it's about prioritizing it, right? And I think one of the most, on a practical level, one of the things we do to fight the good fight in terms of family time and you know, making sure we are having a healthy balance. You know, I think it was Steve Jobs who famously said, you won't find one disruptive, innovative person in the history of the world who had a balanced life, right? From Jesus to Henry Ford, to, you know, to Steve Jobs, you're not going to ever find anyone who was balanced. But obviously you have to give it, fight the good fight and give it your best shot. And I actually think the kids benefit from watching the parents grind, right? I read a study a few years ago that if kids live in a nice house and have nice cars and go on nice trips and they don't see you grinding and they don't see you working hard, then they're going to assume that it's all kind of given to you, right? And they're going to assume, they're going to expect they're going to be rich, when really I tell my kids all the time, you're not rich, right? You're poor, right? And so one of the things we do on a practical level is we take lots of walks. We'll walk on Sunday night, you know, 4 or 5 miles around our neighborhood just to talk through the week and find where the gaps are and find when are we going to see each other and where are the kids going to be and what do they have going on this week. And we literally are constantly having, you know, if I come home and don't know where anyone is and I haven't seen anybody in a few days, I'll say, hey, let's take a walk. And so me and my wife will walk around the neighborhood and just map out the next week and try to figure out where the pockets of time are, right, to see each other. But man, it's hard. It's the hardest. I'd say it's the hardest part of being an entrepreneur, because as an entrepreneur, you go to bed and wake up with all your problems and all your, you know, shareholders you're accountable to and all the employees that are expecting to get paid. And it's you know, you don't ever, you have to force, you really have to force that. You have to find activities that are a forcing function to give you that time with your family, you know.
So my last question to you is for people that are aspiring to be like an entrepreneur, whether they're young, a little bit older, whatever, knowing what you know now, if you could give, I guess, your younger self some advice, what are some things, you know, you could even kind of frame it as if we're kind of teaching our teenagers, you know, because, you know, what they teach in school, you know how they're, like I just said, get a job and work 40 years. So if you got somebody out there, again, whether they're in school or they're out of school, and they want to just, they know that there's more in them than just one thing, you know, they want to be an entrepreneur. They really want to make a difference. They want to provide value. What would you say to that person?
You know, one thing that Willie Robertson from Duck Commander said to me one time, we were playing golf. He's on my LA golf board. He's a really good friend. And he's also a really wise dude. And he said to me one time, I was telling him about all the stuff I was working on. This is before LA golf, actually. I was telling him all the stuff I was working on. I was kind of having a little midlife crisis between Marucci and LA Golf and didn't really know what I wanted to do next. And I had like 17 things I was doing because I didn't know what I wanted to do. And he said, you know, I know you all know. He said, you can do everything in life you want to do. He said, and you can do anything you want to do. He said, you just can't do it all at once, right? And I think if I was talking to a young person who wanted to be an entrepreneur, I would say, don't get paralysis of analysis and think that your next business venture is going to be your career, right? You're not choosing a life path. I always tell young people to avoid the P words, finding your purpose and your passion and your path. Those are things I think that's a lot of flawed advice young people get, like find your passion. You don't find your passion sometimes till you're 55 years old, right? It finds you, right? Sometimes you don't know yourself well enough at 21 or 25 to know what your passion is. You don't even know yourself, right? So I always tell people, avoid the P words, right? Don't go on some you know, mystical journey to find your passion and your purpose and your pathway and your person. Usually your person and your pathway and your passion and your purpose will find you. You'll run into it. You'll collide with it, as long as you're creating value and solving problems, right? And so I tell people all the time that are young, I think the two most important things before the age of 30 is what you learn and who you meet, right? It doesn't matter what your title is, what your salary is, where you're working. It's who you're working for. What are you learning from them? Who are you meeting, right? But at a certain point in your life, and maybe I'm just randomly saying 30, at a certain point in your life, if you want to be an entrepreneur, you need to pick something and say, I'm gonna go all in on this for the next 5 years, right? And it may not work and you may not enjoy it. But if you're creating value, if there's an audience you're creating value for, and you're solving a problem that nobody has solved yet, then you're going to make some money and you're going to figure out that'll lead you to the next project. And maybe the second or third project, you'll figure out what your passion is, right? Or you'll figure out what your life purpose is. But sometimes it takes time. So I think that's my thing, is focus on learning and networking when you're young, but that when you're ready to be an entrepreneur, don't get paralysis of analysis. You got to pick something and say, this is something I'm willing to commit 5 years to. It's not a marriage, right? You're not committing your life to a job or to a project. you can raise some money or start a venture and say, I'm going to give this 5 years, right? And I think not enough. I think too many people spend too much time in paralysis of analysis.
Yeah, I think you're right, because I was going through, you know, the first 15 years going to dental meetings with other dentists. We had to go because you have to have, you know, so many continued education hours a year.
Yeah.
Most of us didn't want to be there. We were there because we had to. So I think I look back and all those years I spent with people that didn't want to be there. And that, but that was my network. That once I branched off into real estate, into places where people really wanted to be there, really want, and I changed, like you said, I changed that network. And it was just like, it's crazy that the can, okay, now because I'm over here, this door opens and this door closes. And it's just like, instead of people thinking, like you said, all right, I'm going to be a doctor for 30 years and that's it. But when you're an entrepreneur, it's just, it's kind of like the stock market, up, down, but it's so cool to know that, hey, no telling. I mean, if I would have told somebody the things that I'm doing now, you know, buying all this real estate and teaching people and all these different things and getting to connect with you, it's just like, I never would even thought about that. I was just focused on going to dental school, you know? Yeah. So it's all, like you said, it's all about your network and providing, always leading with values. What I tell my kids, don't go to somebody, what can you do for me? It's like, what can I do for you?
Right. And you know, but what you did building your dental career, though, sometimes specializing for a period of your life lays the foundation and buys that first home and gives you that first money in the bank. And right, it gives you that framework and foundation to go do other things. But I think a lot of times people don't take that step, right? There's that fear-based decision-making where the inertia is just too strong, right? And so after they've specialized and maybe made some money, they're just too afraid to take that risk, right? And I think I tell my kids all the time that wealth is not, you know, I'm trying to create first-generation wealth. It's really hard. It's really messy. But wealth isn't created by people who work the hardest, right? And that's not the message we were taught growing up, right? I was taught that you work hard, right? And honestly, that's not how you create wealth, by creating value, solving problems, and taking risks, right? And I think that's something that I wasn't necessarily taught as a young guy.
Awesome. I think we should end on that note. So if people want to learn about LA Golf or you or what you're up to, where do they go online?
Yeah, and we're at LA Golf on Instagram. I'm not on social media. I try very hard to stay off of it, but LA Golf is a fun journey. And anybody who's interested, we're pretty easy to find. We're kind of a pretty provocative brand. So
awesome. Reed, it was always good catching up with you. I'm so proud of you from your humble beginnings to where you are now out in sunny California.
Yeah, likewise. This was a blast. Thanks for having me on.